In this video, we're going to compute the electric field inside and outside a uniformly charged solid sphere with radius r and total charge q on it. So we're going to use Gauss's law to get this done, and the first step in using Gauss's law is to choose a good Gaussian surface for the problem. And the point in a choice of Gaussian surface is that you want a surface that shares the same symmetry of the problem. So we started with a surface that's outside the sphere, and it shares the same center as the sphere, so it has the same symmetry as the charge distribution we're trying to study. We'll go ahead and follow this up with a surface that's inside the sphere to get the electric field in there. And by choosing a surface that shares the same symmetry as the charge distribution, we guarantee that the electric field passing through this Gaussian surface is going to have two critically important properties. First, it's always perpendicular to the surface area elements, and second, it has a uniform magnitude over this surface. So because every point on the Gaussian surface is exactly the same distance from our charge distribution, the electric field has this constant magnitude over the Gaussian surface. So we write down Gauss's law, and on the left side is an electric flux integral over this closed Gaussian surface. So the integral of E dot dA gives you the total electric flux through this surface, and Gauss's law says that that's equal to the enclosed charge within the Gaussian surface over epsilon zero, which is the permittivity of free space. And if you need a reminder on where this all came from, I'll post a link real quick to a video with a detailed derivation of electric flux and Gauss's law. Now this electric flux integral simplifies in a couple important ways. First, we have to remember that the direction of the area elements dA is actually the direction of the normal vector at each point on the surface. And because E is parallel to the normal vector, the dot product becomes trivial. And we simply get the integral of E times dA, the product of the magnitudes of the electric field and each dA area vector. Second, the electric field has a constant magnitude over this entire Gaussian surface, which means that constant can be factored out of the integral. So now we have E times the integral of dA. Well, the integral of dA is just the total area of this Gaussian surface, and that's just the area of a sphere of radius little r. So we end up with E times 4 pi r squared for the electric flux integral. Now Gauss's law says that the result of that electric flux integral over the closed Gaussian surface is equal to the enclosed charge divided by epsilon zero. So this means E times 4 pi r squared is equal to Q, that's the total charge on our sphere, divided by epsilon zero. And now we just have to divide by 4 pi r squared, and I'll call this E out for the electric field outside of the sphere. And E out is Q over 4 pi epsilon zero r squared. And this is a cool result because it says the electric field outside this uniformly charged sphere is indistinguishable from the electric field of a point charge of Q located at the center of the sphere. Next, we look at a Gaussian surface contained within our uniformly charged sphere, so we can see what's going on with the electric field inside the sphere. Now again, this Gaussian surface is chosen to share the same symmetry as the charge distribution itself, and this means our electric field again will have constant magnitude across this Gaussian surface, and it will be perpendicular to the surface area at every point. So we apply Gauss's law again, and we'll just set to work on the flux integral first. And all the same stuff happens here. The dot product is trivial because E points in the same direction as the normal vector at every point along the surface. So inside this integral becomes E times dA instead of a dot product. And the electric field is constant over the entire Gaussian surface, so we can pull that out in front. And the integral of dA is 4 pi r squared. But on the right-hand side of Gauss's law, Q enclosed is a little bit tricky this time. We're not enclosing the entire charge of the sphere, it's just a fraction of it. And there's a couple different ways to approach this, but I prefer to introduce the volume charge density rho. That's the charge per cubic meter. And the volume charge density of this uniformly charged solid sphere is the amount of charge it contains divided by its total volume, which is 4/3 pi r cubed, where that's the big R for the entire sphere. So if you take the volume charge density and multiply it by volume, you get the amount of charge contained in that volume. So all we have to do to get the enclosed charge inside this smaller Gaussian surface is take its volume, which is 4/3 pi little r cubed, and multiply by the charge density, which is big Q over 4/3 pi big R cubed. And our 4/3 are going to cancel, the pi's cancel. And I end up with an enclosed charge of Q times little r cubed over big R cubed. So finally, putting it all together, the electric flux integral turned out to be E times 4 pi little r squared. The enclosed charge turned out to be Q little r cubed over big R cubed. And we have an epsilon zero in the denominator. So it looks like two factors of little r are going to cancel here. And we divide both sides by 4 pi. And I'll call this E in for the electric field inside the sphere. And that's going to be Q times r over 4 pi epsilon zero big R cubed. So to summarize what we're looking at here, the electric field strength is zero at the center of the sphere. That's when little r is equal to zero. And then it grows linearly with the distance from the center until we get to the surface of the uniformly charged sphere. And then we switch to the electric field of a point charge. So we have an electric field inside the solid sphere of Q times r, that's little r, the distance from the center, over 4 pi epsilon 0 big R cubed, where big R is the radius of the sphere. And then outside, it's identical to the field of a point charge. That's Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 little r squared. And what we're asked to do in this little follow-up problem is we want to show the electric field is continuous at the surface of the sphere. So we're changing from this rule to this rule at the surface. And it would be nice as a result to a physics problem if that field was continuous at the transition. And mathematically, all this means is that if we sub in big R, we should end up with the same field for E in and E out. So if I look at E in evaluated at big R, that's Q times big R over 4 pi epsilon 0 big R cubed. One of those R's cancels and I end up with a Q over 4 pi epsilon 0 big R squared. Do the same thing for the field outside the sphere. I evaluate that when little r is equal to big R, the radius of the sphere itself. And I simply replace little r with big R and I end up with the same result, 4 pi epsilon 0 big R squared. So that's a nice result. We don't have a discontinuity in our electric field as we travel from the center of the sphere outward. Finally, we want to get a plot of the electric field magnitude as a function of the distance from the center. And this is how the plot turns out. When little r, the distance from the center, is less than big R, that's this region on the left, little r less than big R, and we can see that linear growth of the electric field in that region. At the dotted line is where we hit the surface of the big sphere. That's when little r is equal to big R. And we transition to this 1 over r squared point charge kind of field. So to the right of the dotted line, that's where little r is bigger than big R, and we see that point charge field. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.